Hello, everyone. Welcome to Oakland Tobacconist Live, episode 50. Very, very special episode tonight. I just want to confirm I was having a bit of technical difficulty with audio. So just make certain if you get a chance, just drop down in the comments that you guys can hear me all right, because I want to make certain that it's all legible, it's all audible, you can hear everything. And there we go. So this is the 50th episode. This episode is very special for a multiple of reasons, not only because it's the 50th, but also the brand that we are talking about tonight holds a very special place for me because it goes back into the history of really what got me into cigars. So with that stated, we're going to jump into that. And of course, what makes it ultimately the most special is we have an awesome guest tonight. Tonight, we're talking about Room 101. And tonight we are featuring Mr. Matt Booth from Room 101 himself. We have him on the show, which is going to be an awesome, awesome lineup for all of you. As usual, please drop in the comments what you're smoking. If you're pairing anything, I will pull them as they come. Tonight, I'm lighting up the brand new Snake Shake, which is the Luxury Cigar Club Room 101 AJ Fernandez collab. And it's awesome. It's off to an amazing start. It's the first time I smoked a cigar, so it's already off to an awesome start. And I would be remiss if I did not mention the sampler pack that we have featuring tonight. So tonight we went all out. We have some of the top of Room 101 cigars that is available now and placed into a 7-pack. So I'm going to bring that up. Kaboom. There's our 7-pack lineup for tonight. So you have the Amazing Farce Trilogy, the Connecticut, the original Habano, and the Maduro, as well as the 10th and 12th anniversary sticks that are also fantastic. The Payback Shade, and of course, the Snake Shake. This is available now on our website. If you go to oaklandtobacconist.com, that is where you're going to find it. You're going to see this graphic. That is where you're going to pick it up. So do not miss it. Small amount, but I want to make certain that you guys get the cigars because it is just an insane lineup of greatness and also a great price point for all 7 as well. So this is a great way, whether you've smoked Room 101 before, whether you're somewhat new to the brand, this really does help on both sides. This is a awesome, awesome representation of Room 101 brand. So I'm going to pull some of these. Let's see here. We got Barry jumping on. Barry, thanks for being on. Almost 1 a.m. here. My goodness, where are you located? But 1 a.m., can I keep myself awake for this? Well, it'll be up to myself and, of course, Mr. Matt Booth to keep you up, but I don't think that's going to be an issue. We also have Chip jumping on saying, holy crap, UK? Yes, actually Scotland. Well, thank you so much for joining us from Scotland right now. Let's see here. We got Jason jumping on. Seems good, loud and clear. Good, good. Thank you guys for doing that sound check. We got Rob jumping on. Hello, OGT family. Thank you for giving the shout out. And Jason is joining a Stolen Throne, which is a fantastic, fantastic. Chip is saying you missed the 11th. I know. However, we do have the 10th and the 12th, which are fantastic ones within that lineup. If you guys have not tried either, now is your chance also to try an array of other great Room 101 cigars. We got Peter Jones saying, burning a Black Label Trading Company Momentum Mori tonight for the show. Also a fantastic, fantastic cigar. Absolutely love that one. And Nick giving us a shout out to subscribe and hit the bell. Keep the OGT post video. Well, thank you so much, Nick. I appreciate the support. So tonight is going to be a show of many, many questions and delving into tobacco, but it's not just me. So if you have any questions for Mr. Matt Booth, please drop them down in the comments. I will then pick them up and we'll go from there. If you are unfamiliar with the brand, this is a great way to become accustomed to it, to learn a bit about it. And of course, the man behind Room 101. As I say, this is a very, very special show for me because I would say right now for Oakland Tobacconists, we're going to be hitting our year 3. But originally, prior to the shop and really starting down this journey of smoking premium hand-rolled cigars, one of the first that I walked into a brick-and-mortar shop, picked up off the shelf, was in Santa Barbara, and it was a Big Payback Maduro. I think it was a 6x60. At the time, before California's price just like murdered everything. It was an incredibly, like, from my opinion, it smoked way above its price point. And I was on vacation, lit it up, smoked it. And I turned to my wife and said, there's got to be a way to enjoy this on a normal basis. And of course, shortly after, the next following days, I went back to that same shop, picked up another room 101 to smoke on vacation, and then picked up another one to take home. Enjoyed it so much. So keeping on that radar, it was always, I was familiar with Matt Booth's work and really enjoyed it. And then it had a bit of a resurgence through the Privada Cigar Club when we had the Death Bucket, then Death Bucket 2, and then Naked Booth, all of which have been outstanding cigars. And so it brings me much joy and happiness to be able to bring Room 101 back to the OGT Humidor and represent in the line. Let's see here. We got Chip saying, I'm on the 11th right now, then 12th, and I will get that for a Namakubi. Awesome. Good that far for Namakubi. We got Nick saying, chats are showing up smoking a Sober Mesa Brulee tonight. Fantastic. And Mike just lit up a Farce Connecticut. Fantastic. Well, without any further ado, please help me welcome our guest tonight for Room 101. That is Mr. Matt Booth. Thank you so much for joining me tonight. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having me. How is everybody tonight?
Seems like everyone's doing well, lighting up. I will say also this snake is off to a fantastic start.
We're matching. See that?
There we go. There we go. Mm-hmm. Meeting it together. Mm-hmm. So for those somewhat unfamiliar, Matt, with kind of your journey through the cigar world as a blender and a brand owner, if you don't mind giving us sort of kind of like a breakdown of kind of where it started and where Room 101 has come now.
Well, I mean, I guess if I was going to give you the cliff notes, it would go something like this, you know. Somewhere along the way in my journey, I decided that I wanted to form.
Oh, sorry. We lost
you good?
Audio.
You get me?
Like there we go.
For a second.
Yeah, there we go.
Okay. That was the NSA tapping into our feed.
Uh-oh.
Very sensitive about cigar talk.
Yes.
On the
everywhere.
Internet, obviously. Yes. So somewhere along my journey, I decided to found a lifestyle collective brand, right, that was reflective of not only the good life as I interpreted it, but at the same time, it's really a collection of shit that I enjoy, but done with my twist and my, like, my variation, right, on it. And I've applied that method to everything that we produce under the brand name. You know, I became, I think, initially enamored with the communal and cultural aspects of cigar smoking in connection to my Uncle Lee as a teenager, right? And this is what planted the seed of, I think, what was to become in the future something that was more a far more dominating component of my life as a cigar smoker, and then to, you know, multiply that, I'd say, a thousandfold and become a cigar maker, right? But before we get there, we'll go back a little bit. Is that back for you, or is this back for you? Is that back for
that
you?
Would be back. Yeah.
Which ways?
Yeah.
This is back.
That is back.
We're going to go back.
All right.
We're going to go back to 2003, right? When I founded Room 101 as a made to order and predominantly men's jewelry collection with some offshoot categories like clothing and leather goods and jackets and shit like that. You know, as I evolved that collection, I consistently incorporated accessories for the smoker. But unlike some of the other LA kind of like underground luxury brands that were very cigarette centric in their smokers accessories, I always, you know, made mine to be more cigar centric as a cigar smoker. And let's just face it, this is a luxury brand. The only luxurious way, you know, to enjoy tobacco is obviously, you know, by the smoking of a cigar. This is the gentle person
uh-oh Sorry, not sure why we're getting another freeze frame. Sure, we'll just take a second. Here, let's do this.
That's fucking annoying. I don't think that's my connection, dude.
Here, let's see. Hold on, guys. We're gonna see if we can get Mr. Booth back here.
How about now?
Yeah, that's better. There we go.
Unbelievable, man. I just took it off. Maybe it's the Wi-Fi. I took it off the Wi-Fi connection. Maybe it was something with the Wi-Fi connection. I'm sorry, man. We'll see.
No. Not a problem.
How this goes.
Yeah.
This will be like you know, before WhatsApp, and you go to Japan and come back with a $2,500 phone bill that you had to somehow. Yeah.
Exactly.
I lost my phone. Not saying that I did that, of course. I'm just saying. You know what I'm saying.
Right.
So where did you lose me?
Okay, so kind of delving into making those products for a premium brand.
Right. We got to get this hellbound hayride back on track, because we got dudes in Scotland that are going to sleep, and we got to keep these men up.
We got to keep
pumping.
What I'm
saying? Yes. Keep it pumping, right? So,
yep.
And so one thing led to another, and by a chance kind of series of connections, I started to meet a great deal of people that were already active in the premium tobacco industry, right, in the cigar business, and which I felt very at home, very comfortable with, because I obviously was a cigar smoker and cigar enthusiast. In 2009, through kind of an intelligent / psychotic brand partnership, we joined forces with a company you may have heard of called Camacho, and we produced in Donley, Honduras, what was to be the first Room 101 branded cigar. And that saw the light of day in 2009, although we had been working on that obviously for around a year prior to that. And so it began, you know, kind of funny sidebar to that is that, you know, although I was very much an appreciator and lover of cigars and cigar smoking, I wasn't really up on any brand owner game or any of the business shtick, right? Like I had been fighting my own wars with my company already, and I didn't have the cigar Teen Beat magazine posters in my room yet.
Yet.
So 2009 New Orleans trade show was where we launched the cigar, and unbeknownst to me, I think at the time. Mm-hmm.
Oh, I was going to say, that blend that you launched with, was it just called Room 101, or which blend was it?
That is correct.
Okay.
It's just called Room 101. The cigar.
Okay.
Yes. So,
and how,
Oh,
I was going to say, and how was it received?
I mean, I think horribly would be a great way to describe that. Maybe that's a little harsh. Maybe not as well as it could have been.
Okay.
But, you sit not physically, but fiber optically in front of one of the most stubborn human beings that you have ever come across in your lifetime. So, you know, if I apply my name and my brand name to something, it's going to work, you know, at the cost of whatever that may be. You know, in this case, probably a small component of my soul, maybe. I don't know what we traded for this one. But, that's alleging that it's actually working. I don't know. By the way, you have to give me that photograph, man, because that's fucking hot fire. I need that for my Instagram.
Oh, thank you.
Your
sampler.
Pick.
I will do. Yeah, I will send it over. Well, and I will say that I've talked to some manufacturers about this, and it's sort of a, like, I don't know, you could say it's sort of a small thing. For me, it means a lot, is your labels and the tobacco underneath them photograph extremely well. There's a handful of manufacturers that have that where the label and the tobacco just pops. Room 101 is definitely a part of it. In fact, my wife is a graphic design artist by trade. So we get Room 101 in our shipment. And I was like, you got to come here. You got to take a look at this. And so I'm showing her the boxes. I was like, he's got his graphic design on lock. And props to you. I mean, just the bands, the colors and such, it really offsets the tobacco underneath them. So
thank you.
Thanks for noticing.
I've always felt that is important. I mean, every step of the way, everything is critical.
Right.
Every component
right.
of building the product is critical. And in my opinion is that you must also dress it with the same level of importance as you mm-hmm. apply focus to building it and composing it by, you know, blend or mixture of tobacco and so on and so forth, right? It's all part of a polished, finished and fully baked product, you know?
Yes. I agree.
And I think care and representation is reflective of how, you know, important it is because you're trying to communicate its quality and its importance to someone through their eyeball first. They consume it with their eye before they consume it with their mouth pipe, right? So
yeah.
what they see with their eye has to compel them to shove it into their mouth.
True. It's true. And
right?
I will say for that Room 101, like, what kind of flower is it, by the way?
It's kind of a rendition or a twist on what is meant to be a Japanese cherry blossom.
Okay. So yeah, with that and the colors, I mean, my wife was saying like with the Maduro shade of the tobacco and that navy blue, she's like, it works. It works really, really well.
The shit's
and
hot.
Kind of.
It's hot. Look good. Yes. Thank you. Tell her I said thank you for noticing.
I will. And so Chip is actually wondering, I'm going to pull this question, as I say, I'm going to try to pull some of these comments as we go along. He's saying, Matt, you obviously have an affinity for Asian culture. Were you stationed over there? I was in Misawa and Yokosuka, Japan. I know I'm going to butcher that name. Japan.
I did two rotations through Camp Schwab in the Marine Corps Infantry. And from there, we went out and deployed further into other fine areas of Asia Pacific and beyond.
Thank you for your service.
I was first. Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate that. I was first introduced really to Japanese culture by my stepdad, who was not Japanese, but he was kind of like a very traditional Japanese man trapped in a white guy's body from New Jersey. as fate would have composed his spirit, right? And going to Japan myself for the first couple times really brought us together on a different level, right? And gave me a far greater understanding of him. But I also fell very deeply in love with a lot of the culture that I found there, that I discovered there, you know? And
And
so began, you know, so began my voyage of influence in the next chapter of my life.
Well, and for me, as I had mentioned prior to having you jump on, The Big Payback was very influential in my beginning journey of smoking cigars. And I will say the Namakubi original, I believe it was a 7x48 size, was one of the first boxes I ever purchased as well. From Payback, I went to Namakubi, absolutely loved it. I remember looking up Namakubi. What is that? Oh, it means severed head. Well, there you go. But fantastic blend.
Thanks, man. And Namakubi, you know, I've always said that Namakubi was my third professional, and I want to get carried away with the use of the word professional, but for the sake of the conversation, my third professional release in the business, but my first really good cigar. And you know, not that the others were horrid, but you know, I was getting my sea legs about me at a factory level and really really digging in the best that I could. But you know, at the same time, you know, I was a jewelry designer and a jewelry production manager, I guess you could call it, at our factory, right? For lack of a better set of terms. But I was a cigar lover, but not a cigar producer. So, you know, and I'm sure they see a great deal of folks drift in and out of their factories over the years that want to, you know, want to do something, want to make something happen. And how many of them even, you know, get to the point where they have a product on the shelves in market somewhere, right? You know,
right.
And then beyond that. So, you know, but I always try to, you know, like anyone else's house, I consider their business their house. And I always, you know, bow my head as I enter, right? And submit to the teachings, right? And that's what I did there.
Yeah.
And I learned a great deal, man. You know, I did. But of course, I'm still learning every day. You know, that never stops.
So,
is really where the rubber hit the road for us.
Okay. And in that beginning of like launching the first Room 101 and such, were you working more with Honduran tobacco because of working with Camacho, or were you?
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And when it comes
really
to
really kind of getting a go ahead.
Oh, no. Go ahead. Sorry.
Well, I was just going to say, really kind of getting a handle on doing the most we could, or doing a lot with a little, right?
Yeah.
And which actually really helped me understand the power of the mixture and how, you know, to adjust and modify can influence the outcome. And, you know, when you're trying to provide these very different and by the way, pleasant, you would hope, experiences, you know, there's a whole science to that.
Yeah.
Although so then, not scientific, if that makes sense.
Well, and what would you say that you find more? Because I know, like Room 101 now, and this is something I wish, and I don't want to really say, I don't know. I feel like the term boutique is a little overused. However, I wish there was a lot of brands that use multi-country blends, and I've noticed that somewhat in your Farce series. I mean, you have Pennsylvania Broadleaf. You have Dominican, you have Nicaraguan in your fillers. With Honduran, is there any like simile you see between like Honduran tobacco that brings to the table versus some of where Room 101 is now grabbing Nicaragua or Dominican? Is there inherent like flavors or qualities to Honduran that you notice?
Yeah, of course, man. And we still use Honduran tobacco. I used a great deal of it in Murder Hornet, you know?
Okay.
Murder Hornet was really kind of a throwback style blend for me, almost, you know, really in line with some of the Criollo stuff that we did, like the HN series, things of that nature, you know, a little different, but in that vernacular, you know, everything has its place, man. I mean, I think all these tobaccos have these very signature characteristics to them. Personality traits, character traits, right? And it's far more about what you like than anything else, right?
Well, and I know a lot of people don't like this question because it's almost like asking like who's your favorite child, but do you have a favorite tobacco you like to work with, or a few favorites that you like to work with in a blend?
The Padron 64 anniversary Principate size natural wrapper.
Yeah. Okay.
That would be my favorite of all time.
Okay. Nice. Now, here we got a question from Peter James. I'm gonna pull this up real quick. Why does his name say Rolex Luther on the screen? Is that Matt Booth, a cigar alter ego or something?
I use Rolex Luther for trade show badges, many of my online interviews. I have several names that I like to deploy for certain sessions. I just thought it would be nice.
Yeah, there you go. So for people jumping on, we're talking right now Room 101 brand. I'm gonna pull this picture up real quick again. This is our sampler lineup as it is.
Oh, look at it.
And it as I say, the graphic design is fantastic. The blends are even better. And the Snake Shake is what we're smoking right now. fantastic, fantastic cigar. This lineup is available on our website. If you go to oaklandtobacconist.com, that is where you'll pick up this sampler. And I have to say, too, and I know that you know this because I kind of hounded you for a while about the 12th year. Absolutely love that cigar. Fantastic.
It's off the chain, man. One of my favorites.
It's very, very
one of my
good.
Favorites of all time that we have made for our brand. But, you know, I have so many favorites, and they all seem to be active simultaneously, you know, because at this point, you know, this is really the 14th year that I've operated at a factory level, right?
Yeah.
And so Farce really was meant to kind of be Farce was a very fun and fulfilling process to create as a series because, you know, some of the sentiment that was driving that was like, hey, this is where we're at today. This is our this is our level of capability today, given unrestrained or less than restrained access to materials. And and these are the type of blend compositions that we can produce now.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. So because you prior to Farce, you took like a small sabbatical from blending, right?
I mean, not really. I mean, I said I did, but I kind of lied about it.
Well, and I will say too, like if I think back, like amongst like the greats of Room 101 prior to when Farce existing and prior to the anniversary starting, another one that really sticks out was the collab. And I remember trying to find every interview I could on the cigar because I loved it so much of the tea Maduro.
It's very nice.
Yes. Very nice. Very good cigar. Very good cigar. I wish there's a way to get your hands on it again because that is one of those unicorns that I'm like, fantastic blend. It's really too bad it's not produced anymore because it's great.
I have one here in my humidor. It's one of the factory prototypes. You want it? You can't have it. You want it?
Sure.
I'll send it to you.
Hey, I will take it. Well, hey, you send it to me and I'll get another kick-ass photo of it.
There you go.
There we go.
Deal.
So, and like I said, so from Room 101, Farce starts, and then we start our company. We're still a very young company, still kind of getting our feet wet. And then we jump on with LCA, and we see a lot of blends like the Death Bucket and the Naked Booth, which I'm going to pull this up. Kyle's saying, just smoke the Naked Booth cigar that you did with Pravada. I don't have a question. I just want to say it was such an amazing smoke. I wanted to thank you. So... And I echo it. Fantastic cigar.
Well, thanks, man. I would just like to make it very clear that in that image, I'm not naked. There's a banana hammock branded experience and a cape. It's not naked.
No. I think it should be naked. Rebranded then. Like with that explanation.
I mean, I don't come up with these names. You know. Oh, wait. Wait a minute. We'll change that. It's now changed.
Great. And then I will also say a big influence too is Abe Froman out in Embargo. Fantastic dude. Mm-hmm. And
that's
visiting my boy. Visiting his shops, he's like, so how come you don't have Room 101? And I'm like, I don't know. He's like, well, you got to make that happen. I was like, yeah, I do. Because they're just, it's an all around fantastic lineup. And that's what makes me really excited about tonight's samplers because, you know, once in a while when you put together a sampler pack as a retailer, you're like, yeah, these ones are heavy hitters. These ones are okay. Room 101, just across the board, is a very well, like, flushed out, balanced portfolio. And I smoked for the first time the Connecticut Farce. Thanks. Never tried it. Yeah. Never tried the Connecticut Farce.
It's erotic.
There you go.
It's erotic, man.
Reviewing it, I'm like, the complexity from this cigar is just fantastic. So as it moves, what prompted when you released Farce, kind of like having inhibited ability to really play around with the tobaccos and such like that, what was your vision starting? Did you say, I just want to create the first Farce one and that's great success, we'll create two others coming after that? Or did you have that trilogy in mind from the beginning? Or... what was that journey?
I mean,
like?
I wanted to develop it as a comprehensive and cohesive series, with blends that were equals in terms of quality and experience, but that were, you know, different enough to form a collection, right? While we were promoting and selling the initial Fars Habano, we were developing the other two and beyond.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Awesome. Well, it played out really, really well. And Chip's saying the Team Maduro is one of my favorites. Is there any chance you three will do another collab? Also, he really wants you to do a collab with Nick Melillo and use Connecticut Broadleaf. So I don't know if collabs are something that you have kind of in the works right now or if you're open to.
I'm always open to anything. Like I'm always down, you know. It's fun. Those projects are fun because I think if everyone at the table is invested in the outcome, you always come up with something that neither person would have ever done on their own.
Right.
It's like songwriting or any other kind of mixed creative process. Like you build something together. It's actually one of the more fun, I think, experiences that you could have on the blending side of the business. But then again, you know, every blend is really a collaborative endeavor between, you know, yourself and the factory.
Right.
You know, they're just you know, they don't have, and although, I mean, the factories that we deal with are, you know, they're, I think, respected. I would say, at least I respect all of them and simultaneously known and, entities, right? So they themselves in some way, shape or form are brands, or the individuals that work there have enough clout to their name, right? That people, mm-hmm. you know, give mention to that. Like you mentioned, you know, we made Snake Shake in AJ Fernandez's factory, right?
Yeah.
And you mentioned that, right? In your shout out. So, but I think that, and I've always loved, you know, pushing the envelope. I make push sometimes, you see. And, you know, it's always enjoyable for me because, you know, our brand has, I mean, one of its pillars is to twist tradition, not in a way that distorts it, but to, you know, to show tribute, but at the same time, produce possibly a progressive or more progressive variation on something that's very traditional, you know, and that's, what I think you get if I was to hang my hat on something. What a strange saying to hang my hat. But if I was going to hang my hat, you know, on something about our cigars, I would say that they are, you know, my rendition of something that I love very deeply and definitely a twist on tradition. I don't believe that their formulas are traditional, and I don't think the experience of smoking them is one that you would connect to something that was far more pedestrian or traditional in nature, but still composed with those traditional principles.
Right. It's that for me, I think cigars are definitely that like vehicle that induces the conversation. It induces meeting on that level of commonality. And really it's the main reason why we don't have things like TVs in our lounge and such, because it promotes conversation and I don't want to squash that or kill that community. Mm-hmm. And cigars have that ability to transport you to that conversation, which really kind of harkens back to that tradition, I really believe. 100%.
Oh, they're the great connector and the great equalizer. That's certain, you know?
Definitely. So I know too, and I mean, be interested to hear your thoughts on this. Kind of as the industry changes, there's a lot of, you see a lot of companies popping up. You see a lot of quote unquote boutique brands and such like that. Room 101 always has that longevity to it. And I think a lot has to do with your persistence and your determination in the brand and the blends that you have created. But when I went to like TPE, for example, it seemed like there were so many new companies out there. And the worry, of course, is tobacco supply and quality. So as a brand, And as Room 101 continues to grow, continues to climb, how have you really experienced some of those things like packaging and tobacco shortages? And if so, how do you really overcome some of those things? Like, how do you have the foresight to battle it?
Well, I mean, all of it. All of it. And you're experiencing it all the time.
Yeah.
And I think one of the blessings and luxuries that we have as operators is, you know, our time in grade, our caliber yeah. of relationships and shared mutual respect with our manufacturing partners. And, yeah. you know, I mean, if we weren't built to last, we would have been gone a long time ago. So, you know, I think that I like TPE because I think, you know, in terms of financial pain, the barrier to entry is nearly non-existent there, and it allows for an up and coming brand entity to stand alongside a far more established company and have their voice heard and have their wares sampled, right?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I like that. And, you know, simultaneously, you know, some of those guys won't make it.
Yeah.
You know, and as retailers, who are you investing in? You know?
Right. Right.
And I'm not trying to shit on anybody. I'm just saying it's.
No. Yeah.
Like
it is,
you know, so, but I think far more, the glass is far more half full in that case. Right. Like, you know, okay. I wish that I had had, you know, that type of opportunity to showcase my brand when I was starting, you know,
mm-hmm.
and, mm-hmm. You know, because it would have made it, I don't want to say easier, but it would have made it, well, fuck it. It would have made it easier. It would have, you know, yeah. I mean, I don't know how else to say that, you know,
right.
You know, cause sometimes we forget. And I think that sometimes not everyone, you know, but like, have you seen War Dogs?
I have not.
The movie with Jonah Hill. Oh, bro. It's
I've not seen it yet.
Disgustingly amazing. You have to okay. watch it. It's yeah. one of those one. Look, because I have this process that I refer to as Terminator vision. And it's not on all the time, right? But you understand the term and the readouts and the,
yes.
the scanning.
Yeah.
And you know, there'll be moments in a conversation where someone's head moves mechanically in a way that to me says, wait a minute, they're engaging in deception. And then it goes, and I start watching them right in a different way. And Mike, dude, it's like Tron, you know, like I'm watching them. Right. And, you know, I think that, you know, if I walk around a trade show, my Terminator vision is very much on, and it's scanning every piece of paper good and pop-up banner and carpet. You know how much fucking padded carpet, how much they charge you for that? I mean, it's like the amount of money that these people are forking out to present themselves, I think, I don't want to say it's lost on people. I think that it's not considered
unanimously
by the consumer. By the person even, coming to consume, right?
Right. And even what I hear from like small things about PCA booth, that's like almost unfathomable. Like how much money is dropped.
I mean, yeah. I mean, I want to stick my own fist in my ass when I think about it. So, and as your business grows, can I say stuff like that with you? Are we friends or can I not say
yes.
artistic stuff?
It's the hosting service.
Your reaction was questionable.
No, Terminator vision is on.
Oh, you're nervous now. You're nervous now. Why? Cleveland Steamer Yard doesn't like the fisting stuff. Is that what it is?
No, it's YouTube that we're worried about. But you're fine.
Oh, YouTube.
You're fine.
Well, I mean, obviously, I mean fist pumping to music.
That's right. That's right.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And not the Two Live Crew, because it probably doesn't like Two Live Crew. Yeah, my mom really didn't like Two Live Crew. When I was growing up. But you know what I did the other day? They were trying to figure out how to plug in Bluetooth speakers. And I put on Two Live Crew.
There you go.
It was amazing. It was an amazing. My wife was like, what the fuck? I was like, they work. Yeah. Like, oh, they work.
Listen to them.
Yeah. So, no, man, I think that it's important for people to understand, like, hey, man, these brand owners, right? This is a real effort that they're making, you know? So before you go beating them up a bit, right?
Right.
You know, consider, like, all you had to do was book a flight and fucking show up.
True.
And these guys are shouldering, you know, and in many cases, the weight of the world, some of those guys, I mean, you know, I mean, and myself included years ago, I mean, you had to make every minute count. You had to make that show count, you know?
Well, okay. So, and it's interesting and you mentioned like I like the Terminator vision analogy.
Because, oh, I got it too. I'll disintegrate you.
And unfortunately, some of the brands that I was like disappointed with, these are brands that are like, okay, they have three cigars in their portfolio. They look interesting. And as a retailer, I want to know more about the brand. So simply asking questions like, so your Maduro, what tobacco are you using? Is it San Andreas? And they're unable to answer the question, or they're like, oh man, you're killing me. And it's like, well, if you've only got three cigars in your portfolio, this I feel like is a very important step of being able to educate the person that's essentially going to give you money.
Dark brown.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Dark brown. That's what they should say. They should say it's dark brown. That's what I say. I mean, the three cigar approach, I mean, I've applied that throughout the Farce series. It's, you know, there are truly three cigars, mid, light, and dark brown. My specialty is more in the mid brown range, but I can hammer a dark brown home every once in a while. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And what's, here's another crazy thing. This was an actual experience that happened. I was given a cigar to try on a brand that I was very interested in, brought it back to our shop later. I was like, I'll let it sit for a while, went to light it up, and it had a patch over a part of the tobacco. Like there was a hole in the wrapper.
Like a bandage?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, like a little tobacco band-aid.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
that bro, to me is a little.
You said, "Yo, that's what the band is for, bro. What are you doing?" I'm just kidding. Exactly. Not kidding.
Covered up with a foot band.
At least cover. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
It's weird. It's right. Your band is right here. It's fine. Just.
Yeah.
Art. Design.
That's right. Abstract art.
Yeah. It's abstract. Very strange.
Yeah. So I
mean, look, man. I don't know. I don't know how to even address that. Mid brown. No, you're frozen again.
There we go. There we go. We're back. It's all that fist pumping. Fist pumping. That was starting to stall it out.
I'm telling you,
but
man.
It's just
shit gets crazy.
As a retailer, kind of seeing that's where the industry is kind of going, there is that worry. But I will say, on brands grown that have that longevity, it's refreshing because there is a level of confidence as a retailer being, you should try Room 101. You should try this or that. There's a level of confidence that I have when I recommend that cigar that really is almost priceless because you can know the experience will be positive.
Well, look, they may or may not connect with the experience in terms of flavor or power, and they may... you know, want to cruise on down to the Connecticut Shade side of town or whatever they're going to do. But one thing they will not be concerned about is the physical quality of construction, you know, and mm-hmm. the mechanics of the cigar, you know, the draw, et cetera. Now, look, man, shit happens.
Right.
It happens, right? Like it's a human made product and shit happens. But, you know, at the same time, this is kept to a minimum through constant and consistent quality control efforts, both at a factory level and here domestically. You know, I 90% of everything that I smoke are my cigars. Just I take a baggie of Padron Anniversary bands with me, and then I put them on my cigars so that I can be. Somehow psychologically smoking for my enjoyment. Not that I don't enjoy my cigars, but it's a different effort when, you know, we're smoking now and I'm smoking Snake Shake, but I'm not so disconnected from monitoring the cigar during the process.
Right.
So, you know, it becomes a really juicy and beautiful opportunity when it's like, hey, I'm going to have a couple friends over and we're going to smoke a cigar and not think about it. We're going to enjoy the moment. And I'm not saying you don't enjoy it. Please don't.
I imagine that.
But you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah, from a maker standpoint, it seems like it would be too hard to not become obsessive about meticulously, is it burning right? Is it drawing right? Is it for me the way I want? Yeah.
I mean, it's like I'm fucking psychotic at this point, you know?
But and I think
that's my point. Is that you just have to continue to, that's my job. Part of my job, right? Is because I need to make sure that your confidence is never shaken to a point where you feel like you can't recommend my brand in your store. You know, if our brand is built to last and we're going to stay the course here, which we are, part of that is going to be built on, you know, respect and relationship and confidence that we build with our retail partners. Right. Like, so you can't recommend my cigars and be like, hey, 1 out of 10 bitching.
Exactly.
Get a box and you'll get 2 out of it.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Of course. It does make it more luxurious.
With those blends, like
spend
I said,
$200 and get 2 cigars.
I mean, that means that. Yeah, exactly. You find those like two. It's
you
like
have
a
to
Willy
mark them differently thing. Though. You have to mark.
Sorry, what?
You have to put the band on the thing on the side like that, and then the other ones you don't. Those are like supporting visual support.
There
elements.
You go. And you only sell it as a box. You don't sell them individually. You got to buy the box.
Of course. Yeah, and if they don't want the box, they're like taped together. Obviously.
It could be the cigar for like when you're having friends over and you know you're going to have 5 or 6 guys that never smoke and be like, hey, man, I want a cigar. Be
then
like,
you give them,
here you go. And grab the one that's not the right banded one. They can smoke those. Mm-hmm. And then you get the 2 great ones. $100 cigars.
Mm-hmm. And then you and your other buddy that know better, you see the band in the center of the cigar and they're like, yeah.
Exactly.
I see.
And
I
then
see
by then, you and your friend are enjoying them. And then they don't know cigars, so they're just like, oh, man, they're really, really good. You're right.
They're having a great time, too. Everybody fucking wins.
That's right.
Oh, my goodness. God. See, you. That's so, what I told you. You're never done learning.
There you go. See, but tell me a bit about Snake Shake. How did this blend come about? How did the team up with Luxury come around? What was the evolution of this cigar?
So we connected at some point. I guess in recent history, right? And we really hit it off. I like those guys. I like what they're doing. I very much enjoy this new club model. I feel that it is, you know, although there is not one singular element that is, you know, we're not going to be so dramatic as to say like this one thing is the future of our industry. But I do believe wholeheartedly that this model is a component of the future of our business, and maybe not our collective business, but I know it's a future of my business, you know, because I desperately, you can see the look of desperation. It's like a bead of sweat. You can't see it because look, it's right there. There's a bead of sweat.
Okay, there it is.
I desperately want to connect directly to as many retailers and end user consumers as humanly possible. And I want my voice heard and I want my message to resonate, you know?
Yeah.
And I know that, you know, while we are doing everything that we can to build and not only build new responsibly, but also to responsibly support existing relationships with retailers, they're doing the same with people that we may or may not be directly connected to, right? And so it's intelligently spreading our contagion, as it were, right?
Okay, yeah.
And so so whatever, not to beat a dead cigar horse, but I like it. I like it. And it's a little disruptive. And also, no, fuck that. I'm going to say this. I also like it. It's for the same reason, but it's just like how I really stand back and I appreciate, you know, there being not across the board, because everything has its time and place, but I do appreciate there being a place where, you know, the barrier to entry for new brands to have their message heard is realized, right? And yeah. I think that, you know, that there are, or at least when I came into the business, there was an echelon of industry gatekeepers that was it. Like, they were the gatekeepers. That was it. If you weren't in, you could rattle off the account list. And if you weren't in those accounts, then you weren't really in the game, you know? And although nothing against anyone that would fall into that list, quite frankly, because respect and credit always where it's due, right? And especially based on what I've seen them build, even since I was connected, you know, to the game, and they're my seniors in the business for the most part. But mm-hmm. I think that as a young up and coming brand, even with a product that had merit and a valid message, you would be very hard pressed to win their ear, let alone their business, and therefore your product's placement within, you know, their shelves. So I think that it creates these new channels of opportunity for brands to be heard and seen. And I believe that the consumers will be the ultimate, you know, executioners, right? Like, you either pass or fail their test, but at least you get to them for their consideration, right?
Right.
That makes sense? Like, you have the opportunity through these new, unique channels to once again have your voice heard. And I think that's important.
Yeah. Well, and I think too, it opens up to I think we've kind of seen this in the last like decade or so, a new type of consumer, a very educated consumer. And I think that education in this industry is paramount. I mean, it's very important to learn what it is about certain tobaccos you like or brands that you like, whether it's a meeting on social media.
Mid-brown.
Yeah, exactly. or like watching interviews like this, like finding that and learning, okay, this is why I like this cigar, and kind of moving forward. It's not about like memberships, I think, like Luxury or Privada. It's not about just, we've got extra inventory, let's move this crap along so we can just pump through cigars. It's about really the artisan touch, which I appreciate through those better monthly situations.
Yeah. And every product that I've ever made for any of those clubs has been curated for them as a custom project.
So I'm just saying, out of the gate. I'm just putting out there, Oakland Tobacconist has a membership that eventually, if we could get a Matt Booth Room 101 exclusive, just throwing it out there.
Do you like mid-brown? It's my specialty.
Mid-brown, yes. Mid-brown edging to dark brown, yes. Very, very good.
Yeah, edging. Also edging. I like that. Mid-brown edging. That's perfect, actually. That is my kill zone.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, and like I said, I mean, we, that 12th anniversary, complete home run. My wife smoked the 10th last night, and I kept trying not to steal her cigar because we were comparing notes. She hasn't really tried much of Room 101.
Well, now she has a phenomenal selection via you to dabble in. 10th is so unique, man. 10th was a byproduct of some of my initial blending sessions with AJ that several other products came out of, some that you are now seeing being realized in market and some that are still to come, right? And my goal was to build full Nicaraguan built series because I want this cohesive collection of products. And although, you know, for example, there are products that we make and will continue to make proudly with William Ventura in the Dominican Republic, they are comprised of little to no Dominican tobacco, right?
Okay, yeah.
But they have their touch, and they have their finesse, which is very, very intrinsically Dominican factory production, right? And so, so those blends are also unique because you have some of these more aggressive tobaccos playing these roles in these cigars, but they're a bit suave, you see? Like Farce Maduro, if that was young and undercured, you'd fucking blow your doors off, bro.
Mm.
I mean, that shit would light you up.
I was going to say, it's what's so surprising about that cigar. It's got Connecticut broadleaf, Pennsylvania broadleaf. Like, these are not delicate tobaccos.
That shit would fuck you. You get a couple pops in you, and you lose track of how you're smoking. You cheap one of those down, not in its mature form as far as Maduro, and you'd be laid out, dude. You know, I mean, it'd be very, very powerful, you know? And so I always apply, you know, human personality to my cigars, just kind of how I describe them, you know?
Okay.
And I've always said that, you know, Farce Maduro is like Danny Trejo. Farce Maduro is the Danny Trejo of my cigar collection, because in its youth, it was very aggressive and probably not something that you could take in anything but very small doses, right? But over time, it has softened to a point where the embers of its former self are still very present, but there's a level of maturity and calm that only comes in time, right? And in my man's case, also surviving himself and everything around him, right? And you know, and that's Farce Maduro. So, and you know, some people be like, Matt Booth's fucking a loon, whatever, but I like his cigars. But then there are other people that will somehow resonate with them, and they'll get it. And look, man, I don't describe my cigars the way some other cats do, and vice versa. And that's what makes us all unique, right? And makes our cigars unique too. So, fuck it.
So, who's Farce Connecticut? Because I just smoked that one today, did a review on it. If you had to assign kind of a personality to that cigar, where do you think you'd lean towards?
Morris Day from the time.
Okay.
Yeah, because it's fully sexual. The blend is fully sexual, but it has potency and power. It's not erotic soft. It's erotic. It's very intriguing because it has enough potency to it to keep a heavier cigar smoker very, very plugged in throughout the entire experience.
I agree.
But for someone that needs some candles and bubble bath, it provides that simultaneously. It's a master seducer, as we know Morris Day of the time to be.
Well, and here we got a question here saying, Matt Booth, I know that you said that most of what you smoke are your cigars. What other cigars on the market do you enjoy when you're not smoking Room 101?
Well, and I mentioned that because of the need to oversee quality and consistency, right? I don't attest that my cigars are the only cigars that I smoke. And quite frankly, I celebrate the opportunity to enjoy other cigars. I very much enjoy the Padron Anniversary Series. Fucking hot fire, man. And by the way, if I'm not going to have the opportunity to smoke something different all the time, and I'm going to have that moment carved out where I say, hey, today's the day I'm going to enjoy myself, like, I'm going to go tried and true, man. You know, that's what I'm reaching for, if I can. But I also very much enjoy, I enjoy Nick's Wiseman Maduro. I really fuck with Dion's Candela, man. I really enjoy that cigar, you know, and I've smoked it many times. I really enjoy his approach to that, you know, as well as, if he makes it, it's good, right? And that's another, that brand trust and loyalty on my part that I would enjoy.
Right.
But I like the Candela specifically, you know?
Yeah, no, definitely.
What else do I like? What else do I like?
What's medium brown that
I like,
you enjoy?
I like so many cigars. Oh, mid brown. Well, you know, you know, speaking of mid brown, Pete Johnson offers a, you know, some of these petite Coronas. I believe it's Veracru, if I'm not mistaken. I'm not like,
okay,
he has so much stuff, man, but it's just like, it's a beautiful, you know, good spice to it. The smaller size format really gets you some good potency. Just like little, you know, Pete Johnson in your mouth. It's amazing. amazing. Is that okay with YouTube? So, what else do I like? So much. I smoked, Steve Saka's meat loving thing.
Okay.
I very much enjoyed that cigar. And I really thought that cigar specifically was very intelligently composed, right? Like, and that's kind of also what gets me, right? Is because I was smoking the cigar and I'm like, the cigar is meant to be like a steak lover's cigar, right?
Yeah.
I'm smoking it and I'm enjoying it and I'm sniffing it and I'm examining it and I'm looking at it. I'm like, this is literally the embodiment of a steak in cigar form.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really intelligent, man. I very much enjoyed it, you know? And
definitely.
It's not just, you know, dark brown with the steak label on it. It's like
right.
for that purpose.
It evokes, right? It evokes those flavors.
Yeah.
So when you blend, and actually, I mean, interested, as you said, like petite Corona and such, do you have a size that you like to blend to, or does that vary depending on the tobacco that you're blending with?
Well,
sorry, caught you mid-light.
Traditionally, at a factory level, it's Robusto.
Okay.
Or Robusto-ish. But once we get into a zone that I very much enjoy, I always, and this is just for my own personal enjoyment, I always bring it down to petite Corona. Not to finalize the blending process, but to catch a glimpse of how that's going to perform in one of my favorite shapes.
Okay. You know? Yeah.
And it's a little selfish, but at the same time, I'd say overall, universally, it would be like in the Robusto zone, you know?
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. So once
and then
again,
of course, obviously 80 ring gauge.
What ring gauge?
80.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It's the new Lancero. Nick always likes when I tell him that, because it's the wrapper leaf.
It's yeah.
More wrapper.
Right.
Yeah.
Hog. Well, and for those watching, if you haven't gotten a chance yet, this is our lineup.
God damn, that's a shot, man.
If you have not had a chance to pick up a sample pack, limited supply has the Snake Shake, the 10th and 12th anniversaries, the Farce Trilogy, and Payback Shade. All fantastic. Available on our website right now. If you go to oaklandtobacconist.com, that is where you're going to find it. Question for those new to your portfolio and kind of out of that lineup, and if they're somewhat new to cigars, what would you say are a good place to start in that lineup?
I think Farce Habano.
Okay.
Farce Habano 10th anniversary. Both very different from each other in terms of personality.
Yeah.
But are going to get you on the right path, I think. Those would be my suggestions.
Okay, awesome. And then for those who enjoy a stronger cigar out of that portfolio, what would you say edges towards that stronger side?
I'll just skip to 12th anniversary.
I think that's maybe why it hit that sweet spot for me. That the power and the force behind that cigar is just great. Very well balanced.
Yeah, 12th. I mean, if they have the opportunity, I mean, if we are talking about that sampler specifically, also Snake Shake will not disappoint them. You know. And Farce Maduro, but 12th is going to give a little more bite, you know, and a little bit more white spice through the nose on the retro. Not that that's missing on Farce Maduro, because it's surely not. But you get what I'm saying. It's like a click or two of the volume knob in the upward direction there.
Right. Well, and we got Carlos saying, when is Boofy coming to OGT? So eventually, I know you're a very busy dude, But eventually, we got to do a Room 101 event, have you over to the shop, check it out. And if we could ever make that happen, I think that would be pretty awesome.
Why not?
There you go.
Let's frolic.
Should be pretty cool. But,
you know,
go ahead.
And that's genuine, because normally I tell store owners that I treat cigar shops like AIDS. And I don't want to be exposed to AIDS unnecessarily. I understand very well that there's, you know, medicine now that makes it's very different than the 80s. Like, you could live with it. You know, you got to take some medicine. And that's fine. I still don't want it. You know what I mean? Like, I'd prefer, like, I made it this far. I would prefer to not contract, but for you, I will expose myself to you.
We got to make it happen. That would be awesome. That would be awesome. And it was funny because when we were putting together the sampler, and I was talking to my wife, I was like, "How crazy is this? Like 10 years ago, smoking the Payback, and being like, man, this cigar's so good." And like, I've got to be able to figure out how to enjoy cigars like this on a normal basis. And then I was like, and now he's actually going to be a guest on our show 10 years ago. It's insane, but really, really cool.
You know, when I heard you say that in the intro, I meant to apologize. Like, I feel in some way responsible for this life decision. And I'm sorry.
Indirectly.
You call me later and be like, you know what? I accept your apology. It's fine.
Yes. Yes. I will. I'm willing to even go through it again. So continue to pump out great cigars.
Fucking A.
But I want to thank you so much for joining us on the show. It's been an absolute pleasure hanging out and offering some fantastic cigars here in 2022 for just a phenomenal, phenomenal lineup. And complete well done on Snake Shake. Fantastic cigar.
Thank you, man. Greatly appreciated. And thanks for having me on. I appreciate you taking the time and affording the time to me. My nonsensical ramblings.
It's been great. It's been great. So thank you so much.
It ain't been bad.
And you have a blessed evening. And like I said, we'll be in touch. And maybe we'll get something together later on through the year as the year progresses.
Absolutely, man.
All right.
Thanks again.
Thank you, everyone.
You guys take care.
Definitely. Thank you for jumping on the show. If you guys get a chance to check out Sampler, limited supply. Everyone have a blessed night. You too, Mr. Booth. Thanks for being with us.